I changed plans in what I was going to share today, but I will bring some of that in. I gave a talk yesterday for the Buddhist Council 20th anniversary on the Buddha's teaching in relation to family. So some of that I will bring in here today. But I will start with a poem, because a poem by my teacher, which I have very possibly read some years ago, but it will give some perspective as I talk more about this, in how to bring some of this equanimity, fulfillment, generosity, all these wonderful qualities into our life. I made friends with the white clouds, the grey stalks, who gently reply to the fresh wind, and the bright moon, unaffected by the passage of time. I remain bright and quiet while I sit. A bowl of porridge, a plate of wild greens, a cup of tea. I smile. This is a poem about enough. What I have is enough. What is present all the time actually is enough. So what is in our lives that doesn't feel fulfilling? What is it in our family lives that we feel is missing? The clouds come and go, the sun shines between. We can't dictate those situations, we can't change them. They have their own conditions come forth in the way they do, as so much of our life. I heard a small video on cancer, and it said 69% of cancer is random. It just happens. A young person says, why me? It can just happen. And so much in our life, if we can be with it, is already in its arising fulfilled and totally purposeful. That's hard to understand. But when we look in this second line, who gently, so he's talking about the clouds and the stalks, the nature that surrounds us, that gently replies to the fresh winds, gently replies to the conditions that surround it. A couple of weeks ago, I had someone from overseas who came to stay. And every time she went out, she came across another fellow friend from my property. One day it was the echidna, then the wallabies, then the kangaroos. And she said, you know, it would be many months before she would see nature in her home environment. So she was fascinated, you know, how I live in such a place where there is so much occurrence of nature that surrounded me, or surrounded us. And I see in this things responding just naturally to the fresh wind, to our breath, and what nourishes us. If we look at the, let's say in our family, which is what I was talking about yesterday, which is a little bit more of a, what can we say, a made environment. We bring into our family many conditions or many forces that we have expectations of them, or we want certain outcomes. And so we condition those outcomes from a very young age. We teach our children to be actually like ourselves. And then we get upset when they want to be themselves at the age of two. But they naturally respond to their environment. They naturally respond to the seasons and the nature. They're fascinated, they're open, they're curious and aware. And we're very quickly wanting to mold a conditioning there to desensitize them, not to be distracted by those things. And of course, as we grow up, we start to believe what it is we are taught by our parents and later our friends, or even as a little child. Who teaches a child a lot of things? It's their teddy bear, their dolls, their little fairy friends. Teach them a lot of things. And we respond in a way to want to push this aside and guide them in the right way. And it's very interesting, when the Buddha came along and many other great sages, what they did was say, come back and be with what is, and sit, be nourished and fulfilled with what you have, because it is enough. But actually, it's not so easy to do. It's not so easy to go and sit in a little hut and watch the seasons come and go and have a bowl of porridge once or twice a day with a little bit of greens. It's not so easy to just be with the nature and the storks and the thunderstorms and the raging winds that take the roof off your little shelter in the middle of winter. It's often not so easy to be. Just be. But when we are actually unaffected by the passage of time, by our expectations of tomorrow, by all the things we have to do today, ticking off our boxes, our lists, if for short periods of time in our life we can extract ourselves to go into a retreat, or even for an hour a day, to sit and be unaffected by time, unaffected by the conditions that are fluctuating and changing around us so rapidly, then something quite beautiful happens. We allow nature to enter, and that nature of our deep inner being to connect with that. That which is always there. And we have a sense of joy that arises, a sense of fulfillment and okayness that comes from deep within us, because that is always what it is and what it will be. It will be okay. Even dying will be okay. You know, when a mother has just given birth, she very quickly forgets all the pain that had preceded this tremendous gift of life. And she feels blessed, even more than okay, blissed. So even the suffering, we are prepared to be with that. That's what we're doing all the time in our life. We are being with a lot of situations that are very difficult for us. A bowl of porridge, a plate of wild greens, a cup of tea, and I smile in that order. My life in my little hermitage that I've spoken about before, various hermitages that I lived in, it was simply like that. You know, a very small bowl of the leftover rice was made into a rice porridge for the breakfast. A fresh rice was put on in the morning. I used to take the coals from the fire, had a little pot that I put the coals in and cook the rice, throw a few greens in it. Sometimes I had a little soup, sometimes not. It was enough. I grew a few little greens and a few things to sustain my health. But that is never enough for us now, even in my life. You know, so often my fridge, people come and visit, my fridge is full. And there's me sitting there, you know, trying to share it with my neighbors or give it to the animals. And we still somehow don't feel fulfilled. We don't feel we have what nourishes us. Why is that? The Buddha, when talking to husbands and wives, the husband's relationship to the wife, how to make that fulfilling and pleasurable, the wife in the relationship to the husband, the parents to the children to the parents. He talked to all of them individually. Not that the Buddha actually had a lot to say about marriage as an institution or marriage as a religious ceremony. He didn't talk about these things very much. But he did realize and recognize that a wholesome home environment was not only nourishing and bringing people to the sense of fulfillment and commitment, but it was also supporting the Sangha. If there was too much excess or too much greed or too much selfishness in lay communities, then they weren't interested in the Sangha. That's the case now. If people have too much, you know, too content, too fulfilled, you are not sitting here today. You're playing tennis or swimming in your swimming pools. It is because we know that there is something more than all of that. Being faithful, taking care of one another, being thrifty and curbing one's greed, offering nourishment, developing patience and calmness. These were just some of the things the Buddha would suggest to a husband, to be a good husband and to be the good wife, to be courteous and sociable and bring security to the home. Be fair and loyal and honest. I mean, these are just very simple, practical ideals that we, you know, see as affirmations probably for a good life for anyone. But actually, to be a good moral friend and a companion is not an easy thing. It's different from living alone in a mountain hut and becoming a friend of the storks or the wallaby. because the storks and the wallabies don't necessarily talk back. They might run away, but they don't necessarily abuse you. And how do we offer moral support? How do we bring a moral foundation into our families, into our lives? How do we get... One of the questions asked to me yesterday was, how do I get my children engaged and wanting to understand the Buddhist teachings? It's very difficult if what you're trying to dictate to your children sounds dogmatic. Sounds just, it's come out of a text. It's something you're putting on them, but you're not practicing. Even my parrots teach me that one. That if I'm not imbuing some sort of loving kindness, some sort of care, some sort of concern, they don't come around. The nature doesn't come close. If you're not around for your children will not be around for you when you get older. It's very clear. I once asked a man who came to a retreat, and he'd been to, in Singapore, he'd been to many retreats, both he and his wife were sitting there. And I said, who's looking after your children? He said, oh, the maid. Because I knew he had been to... They were telling me they had been, oh, this teacher had come and that teacher had come and they'd done this and done that. And I thought, well, that's wonderful. But who is the teacher of your children? Who is sharing your nourished lives? Who are you sharing that with? Just yourselves? Other retreatants? That's wonderful. But if we want to actually share something deeply, offer that abundance that grows within us from the Dhamma teaching, then we need to be present. We need to be with that other. Just as in nature, when you actually are right there in an open, fulfilling way, nature just flows in, just comes. They feel very content. A lyrebird came the other morning and looked at me, just turned around, wiggled its tail, and just walked up the stairs, looked back and could see that I wasn't, you know, saying go away. Sometimes I do. When they're digging all the garden out, I do this and they flutter off. But he walked up and then he jumped on. I had a little ladder blocking the top of the steps because there was children up in the cottage. And he jumped up on the top of the steps, turned around. In the past, he's given all the various calls, but this day he didn't. You know, he sometimes does the full show of showing how he can be the Rosella and how he can be the crow and give this array of other calls. He can even be my wooden instrument, my muktak. I hear tuck, tuck, tuck. I'm looking around, you know. And it's the lyrebird practicing the instrument. But that is, you know, when that happens, I stop and I look and I, wow. What's being shared here? But do we do this in our relation the same way with our children? To nourish children in Dhamma, we need to be very present, very interested, very open and curious in what they are sharing with us. I wasn't around so much for my nephews and nieces, I was away for 20 years, and so when I came back, they were already teenagers or had grown up. But I've been around a little bit more for their children, and that's very interesting. They know Auntie Jigwang's there and really interested in them and what they have to share. And so from this, you know, from the baby stage, even from the baby holding them before they could walk, this has instilled some sense of Dhamma. So now when they get to 5 and 6 and they come to my house, one of them said, "Who are all those people around, like the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas? Why all those people here?" she said. And so then it was the right opportunity to explain about the Buddha and the Bodhisattvas. And then the younger one came and said, "Oh, and that's the Buddha, and that's the Buddha," you know, starting to look at the pictures. I didn't have to indoctrinate, and of course their parents and my siblings wouldn't like that. It's enough to be with, because they respond to kindness and they respond to care. We all respond to kindness and care, just as the storks and the wallabies and the nature. Even my plants respond to care. Not that I'm a brilliant gardener. When people give me plants, or we take cuttings, they just get put in. So there's a garden that looks lovely in one sense, but is becoming a bit wild in another. But nature, in every sense, responds to truth, kindness, and care. And when we offer the Dhamma in our attribute of sharing the moral virtues, that means we are not bringing harm to ourselves and others. It's not a difficult problem. But how many of you can honestly say after a Dhamma talk, in your whole Buddhist experience, you haven't gone home and got upset about something? Or 5 minutes, you go out there and you see a monk doing something, or me doing something, and oh, you can't wait to tell someone about it. You know, our mind can be so enlightened one moment, so present and clear, like still water. And we're looking at the nature of mind and what is arising and passing away. And a moment later, we're yelling at someone, often our kids. We go home and the dishes haven't been done, or the meal's not on the table, and the spouse gets a mouthful. Do you think they're going to respond and want to come to your Buddhist class? They're going to think, what's that Buddhist stuff all about, you know? I had two carpenters and my nephew staying for a couple of nights doing some work on the hall. And of course, they can see I'm a Buddhist, and they're polite, and I don't know how the conversation arose, but one of them said, "I'm glad you don't try to dictate your Buddhism on us, or your religion on us." And I said, "Well, why would I do that? You wouldn't listen anyway, you know. You're here for another purpose. Why am I going to start to, you know, want to give you some dogma?" some doctrine. You are not in any capacity of interest to want to listen even. Because the Buddha talked about the appropriate time to offer Dhamma and teachings. When somebody asks, when you're both seated, and it's the right time. As our family values and relationships continue to change, if we look at just the ideal of marriage now, there's many forms. The ideal of who we are as a gender, there are many forms, probably as many on my two hands. We're just learning about them, but the children all have a language for all these different ways of being. And how do traditional families cope with this? Are you trying to ignore it? Or pretend, you know, everything's normal? That their values, their interests aren't worthy because they don't appear to be of the cultural, traditional values I've upheld? Of course, you know, children now, the Koreans wondered when they came to Australia why suddenly their children weren't coming to the temples and were wanting to marry Christian girls or boys, because they'd been put into a Christian education very early. And rather than the parents sharing something of what they had learned from Buddhism, other than going to temples and praying and putting money on the shrine so they get something. We used to say they put a chonwon is like a equivalent to a dollar on the shrine, but they really want to get $100. So they pray to the Buddha really hard, 3 hours of bowing and praying, you know. This is a very common. So of course the children look at this and they can't see any relevance, any truth in it, because they already are a little connected to the natural forces of what's arising and passing away in their lives and their situations and their various environments. That doesn't fit into their experience of life. Their experience of life is, you know, well, if I give this to my mate, you know, we may have an exchange. But not always. The experience of life is, even though I offer something, I may not receive something in return. Like I might be very kind to that friend, but that friend may not necessarily be kind to me. So they're a little confused about this bartering. What they are needing from the parents is this guidance, this sharing of the parents' fulfillment from the Dhamma. They're needing that encouragement and that capacity to listen to and be with. Often now we find that children, when they go to school, they want the teachers to be the parent. They expect the teachers will give them the moral guidance, the ethical guidance. And what happened recently in the last couple of years, where the religious education was removed from schools, it wasn't replaced with anything. We thought it was going to be replaced with some sort of ethical education. It wasn't. So what they did was they put money into having a child counsellor. Now there were probably some reasons, good reasons, to remove RI from school. But the child, I know one child psychologist actually who works in a school, he says it's very, very hard because their parameters are very limited. But naughty children get sent to them. They're supposed to sort out the behaviour of the naughty children. If it doesn't happen quickly, then the school is not happy. You know, why haven't you fixed all the problems of this child? He said, well, I have many problems myself. So it's not that easy, even with the Buddhist practice, to fix all the problems within myself in a short time. I'm not going to resolve all the issues with this child. So as our society becomes a little more fragmented, the importance of us finding family in different ways, being nurtured by community in different ways, becomes more and more important to us. So when I come here, I see people who come once a month. Some of you might come every week, but you feel that when you come to the Buddhist Society, you're nourished in a way that you feel connection with other people, friends. You feel connected to this form of practice or this form of Buddhism. Mind you, I cannot offer the very traditional form of Theravada Buddhism, but I can offer a little from my experience. And when I went yesterday to the 20th anniversary of the Buddhist Council of Victoria, I saw familiar faces that go way back in that story. And that society or that council that developed over 20 years, because I was part of it from an early time. And we, you know, those of us who've shared in that environment, we also have been nourished by one another to fulfill those purposes. Much of that had to do with the early education of RI in schools, religious education in schools. It had to do with chaplaincy and working in the aged care or in the prisons or with people who are dying, pastoral care, spiritual care. So it developed these frameworks, these opportunities for people to learn the skills of helping others bring the Dhamma into ordinary everyday life situations. Sometimes it does need very skilled people to educate us because they've gone through a thorough education that has offered skillful means, we may say, skillful tools to share Dhamma in appropriate ways, in appropriate places, at appropriate times. Just to know the words is not enough. To change the mind of somebody who has a history of mental illness is not going to happen because none of us here are Buddhas. At least, I don't think so. I'm not a Buddha, so you may be a Buddha, but not in the traditional sense of Shakyamuni Buddha. In the essential, innate capability and possibility, you are. We say there is a fundamental, essential place that is the potential for us all to become a Buddha or at least an Arahant. But I don't think we are there. So we are going to have flaws, we're going to have limitations, we're going to have problems. Our children are very likely to have some problems and some differences of views. And how are we going to learn to work with those and deal with them and embrace them is going to be where Dhamma helps us, where meditation helps us, where guidance from teachers help us. but they help us primarily to be honest and real and true and generous beings. When we give of ourselves, we give of our time, we give of our skills, we give of our capacity to speak in a way that makes others feel at ease, then we're in a capacity to raise children who will want to go more deeply into the path of Buddhism, of the Buddha. They have to gain our trust. When we actually think about what I was saying in that poem, and what you would find in a family, whatever form that family is, a traditional nuclear family, this family, our workplace family, is the trust and the spiritual gains from our practice. They offer us shelter. They offer us protection. The precepts offer us the capacity to feel safe. This shelter is what is a very interesting thing when you think of a sage or somebody who's practiced in the mountains. Without that shelter being developed within from practice, you can't go and sit out in the elements and feel fearless. You can't feel so open and you can walk into any place and feel at ease and feel you can offer something without that sense of having developed within yourself the nourishment that brings that security, that protection. It is that you can take out and share with others. It is from that place that others then feel guided and nurtured and sheltered and supported. And a very wonderful thing, you know, as we learn that life isn't about a PowerPoint presentation. It's not just about what we learn at school, or what you learn here, is that as you do start to feel nourished through your own tradition, you can actually be nourished by other traditions, other teaching. I'm very comfortable with interfaith, so I get invited to it a lot. I'm very comfortable with cultures. Happy to, you know, cultures are wonderful things because they have not just popped up yesterday, they're thousands of years old. They've developed over very long periods of time. What works sustains, what doesn't falls away. So each of our, I look in this room and I see people from many cultures, many countries, many backgrounds. And I'm nourished by that. I'm actually deeply inspired by it. Having lived in a culture that was not my own for many years and only just scraping the surface of understanding that culture, even though I understood the language. I tell you, very difficult to understand humor in another country, in another culture. You know when you've understood that culture is when you really understand their jokes. I'd have a smile and ha ha ha, but I'd have no idea what they're talking about, you know. It'd sound rude, you know, I knew the words. But I didn't know the story behind that joke. You know, planted there 500 years ago when a king did something to someone. So you got that one, you got that point. You know, one of the things that happen as we feel secure and nourished is that joy, that deep inner roar of laughter arises very naturally and we see the humor in life. We see, even in, you know, people, I've been with people and suddenly the family all burst out laughing. And here's mum about to pass away and even she starts laughing, you know. I was with a lady holding her as she was dying in Korea, and she wanted to do this purification. It's just putting a little incense. I got bitten by insects lately, so and a little incense mark on you. And she was, you know, saying all the things that she forgave this person and she forgave herself about that. And then she looked up at the sparrows nesting. And I said to her, I've watched those sparrows come back many years. And I'm holding her and I tell her the story about the sparrows. And I said, you know, watch the man. He's making her do all the work because he's got very clever. Now, I'm not saying this against the men in this room, but this situation, I had watched this pair of sparrows and they'd just get the nest. From the day they came together, they were babies. They both made nests. He was trying to make a nest and she was making a nest. And she made it because she's going to have the eggs. She made it so it stuck on the wall. And his efforts didn't quite get there. So she might have had a little more experience. So eventually he decided her nest was okay. So then they had the babies and I used to put a nail, five little nails out on a part of the wall. So they, when the babies came, you know, they'd all have a nail each and they'd all fight about the nails. And then when they flew away, they would fly around and they'd go off and he would have another nest somewhere. The first 2 years he didn't, but then he started to have another nest. And that was very interesting. He would disappear early. So there was just mum flying away with the babies. And I think then he would come back with another family. Very interesting. This is, I'm telling her this story. And it's all related to her because she actually married a man who was married with five other children who didn't want her to have children. And she was a beautiful woman, this woman, and a very kind, very generous Buddhist lady. Bogwang Shim was her name. And she supported the monastic because something was not fulfilled in her life, in her relationship. He didn't want her to have children, so she had many abortions, which was once the way the women stopped having children. And she had one son. Then she got cancer. And we're looking at these sparrows and telling this story about the sparrows, she started to laugh. And she was laughing, you know, quite. There was nothing to her at this stage. You know, I'd been picking her up and putting her in this room and taking her to that room and letting her have, you know, the last weeks in a very natural way. And she started laughing and wanted a glass of water. And I said, but you can't drink, just wash your mouth, you know, just wet your mouth. And I had the spittoon there, the bowl there. And she looked at me and she went, with this big smile, and she gulped it down. And in that moment, the eyes rolled back. And she just passed away in my arms. And I thought, that's actually, it is an intentional death in that moment. But it was a good moment because she saw something about her life. In that moment, she saw so clearly, this is what happens. This is what can happen because of so many conditions. We can't always, we can do the right thing ourselves, but we can't always predict the outcomes. We can't always change the other. We cannot change the other than they responding to the changes we do within ourselves. And so that was a very interesting experience for me on many levels, and I reflected on it for a long time because the monks gave her a very beautiful passing, and monks and nuns came and chanted for her. We put her in robes. They even covered her in a robe like this because her virtue was impeccable. Her virtue, her own virtue was impeccable. But I would not have guessed that last moment. I wouldn't have given her the glass of water. But anyway, the Buddha said, your thoughts can go anywhere, but wherever you may go, you will never find anyone that you love more than you love yourself. So it is that each person loves himself to the best. Nurturing ourselves to the best is what nourishes others. Thus, one who knows that each person loves himself most should not and will not harm others. By knowing and nurturing ourselves, we embrace others. There's just a couple of little things that I want to share here. We've talked about accepting change, the changes even within our children and their lives, and how we can be with that, and encouraging challenges. Didn't talk so much on this. Encouraging ourselves to challenge new parts of ourselves that we have thought, we cannot do that, or we won't do it, or I don't want to do it. But we know it is good for us. So challenging ourselves to go on a retreat, or sit every morning in meditation, or listening to a Dhamma talk once or twice a week. This is what nourishes us. And simple respect. Doesn't matter if a baby is 2 months old, they respond to our kindness and respect, as to someone who is 100 years old, as to the nature and the animals that live in our environments. We swear at them. You can hear a cockatoo, we'll let you know about it. And developing a greater awareness of what is, a greater awareness of what is both within our life and without. An awareness of not only, politics is very difficult to develop a kind and compassionate awareness towards, but when we hear it, what's going on in our thoughts? Do we, swear and curse, that president and that country doing that, and get heated and angry and telephone someone quickly to vent all our, how do we do this? Yes, we're going to be not always agreeable with everything, but at the same time we can learn to have an open, equanimous and respectful response. That is something that's very clear in the Dhamma, and many very good teachings on how to do this. And the last one here, I'd just like to say, to learn to embrace the unknown. That's what you do when you meditate. You never know what's going to arise for you, but you learn to be with it. The unknown being in other cultures, in people who think differently. It's very easy to be with people who think like me. It's very comforting. That's why we're all here. But also to embrace what it is we don't know. And the children, for the young people here, your children are going to come home and share a lot about what you don't know. The two-year-old who knows exactly what to do on an iPhone, exactly what buttons they press will get them to what they want. I learned that, one of my grandnieces at 2 picked up her mother's phone, knew exactly how to get into the photos. and do this. Until she saw one of herself, and then she'd stop and look at it. At two. So if we don't embrace the unknown, I tell you, you know, you will have an experience of a child, maybe not one of your children now, but one of your grandchildren or great-grandchildren, who are going to be very different. Yes. So I will leave this talk now. If there's any questions, please, you're very welcome. But thank you very much, and I hope at least one or two small points of this talk are going to be reflected on, at least for today. At least when you go home, don't abuse someone in your family because you're cranky about this talk or you didn't get what I was saying. But thank you very much. And